Today is October the 1st, 2015, and we are partway through the Feast of Tabernacles. Our focus has been on the priestly law, sacrifice, and purity in particular. So let's pray and get into things.
Gracious Heavenly Family, thank you for these amazing times that you have given to us to celebrate your love and your provision and to celebrate the gospel.
Amen.
Thank you for giving us truth, and thank you for teaching us as we are able to take it in. And thank you for pushing us and challenging us to exercise our minds to be able to learn more and more. You know how in need we are of understanding all the principles of heaven. And so as we delve into your word, I just ask, sister, that you would be with each one of us, bringing the love of your Father, our brother and mother, and showing us what you have truly called us to do and to be. So bless us with the ability to take in these truths and to retain them and to impart them to others. And we thank you for how you're encouraging each one of us and helping us to rise above the obstacles that the enemy puts in our way. And we know that you will continue to take care of us and that we'll still go through hardships. It's still a sinful world, but that we can take comfort knowing that you have a better end in mind for us. So we thank you in the name of Branch. Amen.
Amen. All right, so at the beginning here, let's discuss a little bit about certain principles that we can look at and that are very helpful and important. And these principles, obviously principles are very broad in their scope and apply in multiple areas, but the question was asked about the Sabbath, and we'll look at it in terms of the Sabbath to get a view of these principles. So, you know, there's the passage in Romans 14 that talks about one man esteeming one day above another, and another man esteems every day alike. And a lot of Christians have the perspective that that means that it doesn't really matter what day we worship on. And different Christians have different perspectives. Some believe that it just simply doesn't matter. And then some believe that Sunday is the day we are to worship on. And in the New Testament, I mean, even though Paul in Romans says that some esteem one day above another and others esteem every day alike, we know from Scripture, both Old and New Testaments, that God doesn't count every day alike. And, you know, in the beginning of Revelation, it talks about the Lord's Day. Well, what's that? I know most Christians say that that is Sunday, of course, but again, there's no actual evidence for that. It simply doesn't say Sunday, and the Lord's Day all throughout the rest of Scripture is the seventh day, the Sabbath. But a couple principles that are really important to keep in mind with all of this is some simple, very foundational principles, and kind of a way to highlight what those principles are, sometimes it's to ask questions. And a good question to ask to get a grasp of a certain principle is simply, what is truth? And this principle is highlighting, what is truth? How do we know it? And it really is very important, because it really does affect every single subject. All the meetings before, I've asked people, you know, why is such and such a thing true? Why is this creation true? Why are all these different things true? And unfortunately, a lot of believers end up having the type of mindset that the reason why something is true is because, well, the Bible says so. And that seems like a good, you know, fine answer. But the problem is, if the reason why something is true is because the Bible said so, or a certain book said so, then how do you either prove or disprove the Bible? If someone simply doesn't believe in the Bible, then how can you even show them what that truth is? And then what if, you know, someone else came along and had another holy book, and they said, well, I know that this is true because this book, which is sacred scripture to me, this book says that this is the case, and it's true because it says it. Well, if the standard, the ultimate standard of truth, lies in one religious text or another, then you have no way of actually proving or disproving that sacred text because you have nothing to test it by. If it is the ultimate test. And so, in which case, there's no, you would have just as much reason to either accept or reject the Bible as compared to any other book for claiming to be some sort of divine truth. So that kind of presents the problem. The other thing is that Scripture itself tells us that Scripture is a witness to the truth. It's not the definition of truth, the thing that makes something true. And we have this, you know, Christ said, search the Scriptures, for in them ye think ye have life, King James language there, but in them ye think ye have life, but these are they which testify of me. That's showing that the Scriptures are not the thing which makes something true. They testify to the truth. And I'll just get that passage for you if anyone is wonder found. It's John 5:39, where Christ said that in the Scriptures you think you have life, but these are they which testify of me. So it's not the Scripture itself where the answer is found, but they testify to a reality, you know. And the other way to realize this is that, well, if we say, for instance, that creation is true because Scripture says so, Scripture made it true, then you have kind of the incongruity of the fact that creation necessarily preceded Scripture. And was it not true before it was written down? All of that is just showing us that, okay, so something is true not because of the reasons that many religious people think it is, but the truth of something is determined simply by the fact of it being real. And I know we've talked about some simple examples before, like if I say, we're on this meeting right now, is that true? And the obvious answer is yes. And then if I say we're not on this meeting right now, well, that's obviously a false statement. And what is it that determines whether it's true or false? Well, it's just simply what is actually happening versus what is not actually happening. So truth is determined by reality. Truth and reality are synonymous terms. So when you take something like the Sabbath, this is something that is so often missed. It's like, okay, is the Sabbath the sort of thing that could just change one day? Is it the sort of thing that someone could come along and say, well, now the Sabbath has moved to another day, or now, no, that's not the Sabbath anymore. It doesn't really matter. Well, no, the Sabbath is the Sabbath because that's the way it actually happened. That's reality. The Sabbath is a memorial set on a weekly pace, starting from the seventh day of creation and going on. That actually just can't change. for people who celebrate birthdays, you can't just change your birthday. It's the day that you were born on. And so that's what it is with the Sabbath. So here's the thing. Let's kind of transition from that to another principle that does relate in how people work through this issue in their mind, but it has another aspect to it. In Sunday-keeping Christianity, the primary argument, and in fact, all of the arguments, if you really look at them and reduce it down to a principle, everything is trying to show that the New Testament or the apostles or the early Christians kept Sunday or didn't keep the Sabbath or in some way them no longer having the seventh-day Sabbath be relevant. Now, here's the thing. If someone could prove that in what we've just learned about what defines truth, if someone could prove that the apostles and the New Testament and the earliest Christians and even Jesus himself, if someone could prove that they did away with the Sabbath, would that prove that the Sabbath is done away with? No, it wouldn't, right? Because we just learned that the Sabbath and everything else is not determined by someone said so. You know, so the fact that if the apostles were to say that the Sabbath is no longer relevant and now it's another day or now no day matters, that can't be true just because they said it. So it must be tested according to a reality. And Paul himself, he didn't want people to take his word for it just because he said something. They had to go and test him. And that's found, of course, in Acts 17:11, when it talks about the noble Bereans and how they searched every day. And Paul commended the noble Bereans for searching to see whether these things were so. They tested him. He wanted people to test him. And what were they testing him according to? According to the scriptures, what came before him. So if he said something that went contrary, they were to reject him, you know? But here's the thing, bottom line, if the apostles or even Jesus himself came and taught against the Sabbath, that cannot, by the definition of things, change the Sabbath. It wouldn't be proving the Sabbath to be changed. It would just be proving the apostles and Jesus to be wrong, to be false, to be false prophets and a false Messiah. They came and they, you know, the Jews in the time of Christ had to test the message of Christ and the apostles according to the truth of the prophets that had come before them. Simply, again, if someone could prove Sunday from Scripture, from the New Testament, or could prove that the Sabbath was changed according to the authors of the New Testament, it wouldn't prove that the Sabbath is changed. It would only prove that the New Testament is false. Notice how the New Testament, even in trying to show everything that it does, it's trying to show it from the Old Testament. You know, read Hebrews, for example, and, you know, many other places in Scripture. It's always trying to show, well, this is in fulfillment of the prophets. This is in fulfillment of the prophets. Well, if it matters what the prophets said, then it matters. You have to apply that principle all across the board. And you read in the writings of the prophets, you know, tests of the prophets in Deuteronomy 13, Deuteronomy 18. You read Isaiah 8:20 to the law and the testimony. If they speak not according to these things, it is because there's no light in them. You know, according to all of that, if a prophet came and taught against the law, according to the Old Testament, they are by definition a false prophet. So this question of the Sabbath is bigger than just the Sabbath. Is the New Testament true? Were the apostles and Christ actually valid? And there are Jews today who argue against the messiahship of Jesus and the inspiration of the apostles by saying, well, look, they did away with the law, and according to the prophets, if prophets come or people come proclaiming to be prophets and they teach against the law, they take you away from the law of the Most High, then we're supposed to know that they are false prophets. That's what was told to us from the beginning. That's what the prophets say. So, again, those are really important principles for people to grasp, because if you're going to try and prove that the Sabbath isn't relevant, and you're going to try and prove that another day is the new Sabbath or whatever, what you're really doing, if you're going to try and show that that's what the apostles and Jesus taught, is you're turning them into false prophets. So that's a basic principle. Another thing on the Sabbath, you know, that's one step of things. Another aspect is, you know, just look up the term Sabbath in the New Testament and read every reference, see what it says. Look up words like Passover or feast, or commandments, or law. And all the way through, what do we find? Well, Christ and the apostles all kept the Sabbaths. They all said that they don't do away with the law. Christ said, I have not come to destroy the law. Paul said, you know, that we're justified by faith. But then, does this forsake the law, or do we forsake the law? Does this destroy the law? God forbid, no. The law is established by faith. So all of this is, it shows that the New Testament and Christ did not teach what people claimed them to teach, and thus they are not false prophets. And even there's a place that says, this is in Deuteronomy 13, where it says that if a prophet comes and he speaks a word and it comes to pass, but he leads you to worship other gods or to break the commandments of God, know that he is a false prophet. So even if he prophesies correctly, but leads you away from the commandments of God, has to be false. So therefore, someone couldn't even say, well, the New Testament does away with the law, but it fulfilled prophecy, so it must be right. And Jesus gave good prophecies, and, you know, Revelation has true prophecy and all that, therefore it must be right. No, if you're going to say that it has true prophecy, but yet it does away with the law, according to Deuteronomy and Isaiah chapter 8, verse 20, it's false. They're still false prophets. So those are some basic principles, and of course there's more on any particular passage that someone might raise. Do those principles help at all, Mary?
That's fantastic, and actually I was asking a lot of my Seventh-day Adventist friends at work, you know, what they would say, and this whole principle thing is so huge for our brains to just function and understand Scripture on just all levels. And so it's just an excellent opportunity even just to teach the rest of them about the whole concept of principles. And no, this is perfect. Thank you very much. Perfect.
Praise our Heavenly Family. Thank you so much, Heavenly Family. All right. So what hopefully we'll get into perhaps this time is starting into Leviticus. Of course, we're open to wherever our Heavenly Family leads us in discussion. So I know that however many people here have been studying certain things. I'll just ask, does anyone have anything that they wanted to mention from their studies into the priestly law? We'll wait a while, but we won't wait too long. I know that people often want to wait for someone else to have the first opportunity. But since there was already a pause, anyone who has a comment, just jump right in now without waiting longer. And if not, we'll get right into Leviticus. Okay. Leviticus it is then. All right. So, in Leviticus, we're going to start at chapter 1. We've already in previous studies kind of talked a little bit about the overview of Leviticus, at least the first part. We talked about basically the overview of chapters 1 to 16. The bulk of the book after that is often referred to as the Holiness Code, and it, of course, is very relevant for this whole discussion as well. In fact, in looking at Leviticus, we did the other day read the first two verses, but we didn't get beyond that. So let us do that, starting from Leviticus chapter 1, verse 1 again. And we're going to go through perhaps the whole chapter, but we're going to start with reading the first two verses, and then we're going to read verses 3 to 9. And Leviticus 1 is basically the regulations for the burnt offering. So we're going to get a bit of a grasp of this. And Heavenly Family, as we're just getting into reading this now, please do bless us. Help us to think according to your thoughts. Help us to study as you want us to study. Thank you so much, Heavenly Family. Again, there were some beeps from...
Yeah, Mom, it's your phone. I don't know what may be happening on your end, but...
Yeah, I realize it is now. I was just moving it again, and I moved it just prior to him saying that earlier. My phone is on mute, or it was. I unmuted myself. But evidently, see, I'm driving, and evidently when I move the phone, if I touch the screen at all, it makes those noises, so I'm trying not to touch it, but...
Okay, sure.
Sit down where I couldn't hear you very well now. I was so careful to move it this time, and you heard it anyway, so... but I don't understand why you can hear it when it's on mute, because it sure was.
Yeah, hard to say.
Every phone's different.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to go back on mute partly.
Okay, sure.
Try not
hardly.
To. Okay, all right, sorry.
All right, that's all right. Would anyone like to start reading for us? And just to read the first two verses of Leviticus?
I read for you last time. I'll be glad to resume.
Sounds great. Yeah, just the first two verses at first, and then we'll kind of go on from there, I think.
Introduction to the Sacrificial Regulations. Leviticus 1:1. Then the Lord called to Moses and spoke to him from the meeting tent. Speak to the Israelites and tell them, when someone among you presents an offering to the Lord, you must present your offering from the domesticated animals, either from the herd or from the flock.
Okay. So again, we have the idea that the offerings are to be presented from the domesticated animals, from the herd or from the flock. That's basically the first regulation that we find in Leviticus. And so it's going from a very broad thing, and then it specifies down more and more as we go. Does anyone have any comments on that before we continue?
I have a question. When it says the offering is from the domesticated animals, then it says either from the herd or the flock. Does that imply that the flock is also domesticated?
Yes. So it's kind of two categories within domesticated animals, from the herd and from the flock. And as we read the different regulations, like verses 3 to 9, outline the burnt offering regulations for an animal from the herd. And then verses 10 to 13 give the regulations for a burnt offering for an animal from the flock. And so those are the two main categories that it gives. There are also birds. It's kind of interesting that it doesn't mention that in verse 2. It doesn't even mention the birds.
So some people might be thinking that the flock means a flock of birds, but it's not. It's like a flock of sheep or whatever.
Yeah. So herd is...
Turtle, okay. Turtle hove had come to mind, and I was just wondering if people were actually raising the turtle doves for this specific purpose.
That's what I thought. It might be going through your mind there, yeah.
Right, okay. Yeah, so it's basically the way that it's using these terms here. Herd is basically bovine, and flock is basically sheep and goats. And then birds is its own thing. But birds, many of the sacrifices that are bird sacrifices is simply the bird being offered in place of something else because the person couldn't afford to buy or, you know, to use another animal. But then there are other sacrifices where the bird is just there, and that's the command, to use the bird.
Interesting reading the note 8, number 8. The last line in the note, last sentence, says, an overall category that includes both herd and flock, quadrupeds.
Right. Yeah, quadrupeds.
Right.
Yeah.
Four-footed.
That's animals. Right.
Not like birds who only have 2 feet.
Right.
Yeah. So, and I'll just mention also, just in case anyone wasn't sure, what Michael is referring to when he said footnote 8, that's reading from the New English Translation, the NET Bible, and it has lots of footnotes, actually over 60,000 footnotes for the whole Bible. And it's overall a really good resource simply because it allows an English speaker and reader to access the original language is a lot easier than they might otherwise. Any other comments on that before moving on to verse 3? All right, shall we go on to verse 3 then?
Sounds good. Amen.
All right.
Shall I continue?
Sure.
Burnt offering regulations, animal from the herd. Chapter 1, verse 3. Quote, if his offering is a burnt offering from the herd, he must present it as a flawless male. He must present it at the entrance of the meeting tent for its acceptance before the Lord. He must lay his hand on the head of the burnt offering, and it will be accepted for him to make atonement on his behalf. Then the one presenting the offering must slaughter the bull before the Lord, and the sons of Aaron, the priests, must present the blood and splash the blood against the sides of the altar, which is at the entrance of the meeting tent. Next, the one presenting the offering must skin the burnt offering and cut it into parts. And the sons of Aaron, the priests, must put fire on the altar and arrange the wood on the fire. Then the sons of Aaron, the priest, must arrange the parts with the head and the suet on the wood that is in the fire on the altar. Finally, the one presenting the offering must wash its entrails and its legs in water, and the priest must offer all of it up in smoke on the altar. It is a burnt offering, a gift of a soothing aroma to the Lord.
Okay. So here, that's the first detailed regulation for any offerings here, and it's the burnt offering. The olah is what it's called in Hebrew. I think it would be good for us to kind of go back over that in detail and ask some questions and get ourselves into that mindset of studying. And maybe to start that off, I'll just ask, does anyone have any observations or comments or questions, just anything that they want to say in relation to what was just read?
Well, we talked about this last night a little bit, that the priest is the one who's doing the interacting with the altar. He's the one who's interacting with the fire and the wood, but the person who is bringing the burnt offering is the one who cuts its throat and interacts with the animal itself. And I was thinking about that last night as I was going to sleep and just thinking about what that would be like, you know, if you were a person bringing an offering and you had to put your head on that animal. It was an animal from your herd or flock, so it was your animal that you'd raised. It wasn't just some random animal. And, you know, you had to put your head on the animal. You had to cut its throat. You had to actually start cutting it up. You had to skin it. And you had to wash it and those things. And so I was just thinking, wow, you know, that's really meant to make you think about sin and think about the sacrifice for sin and what a big deal it was, you know. And I was thinking about at the end of it when he's washing the entrails and the legs in water, and then it gets offered up in smoke, just wondering about, you know, the idea that, you know, legs possibly having to do with our walk and the entrails having to do with our mind, and just thinking about that, you know, going up in smoke, and the idea of, you know, our walk, our way of thinking has to just be, it just has to go up in smoke, you know. And I was thinking about a person who brought that animal, you know, if they approached it in a callous way and it was just cut, done, you know, kind of a thing. And, okay, that's over till next time. But that's not where Heavenly Family wants us to approach it. And if you're really thinking about it, you know, when you're really trying to get all the meaning out of it, it would really change you, just going through that experience.
Yeah, I think that's a really valuable way of approaching it, thinking about it in terms of actually going through that process and slaughtering an animal and how really awful that is. And there's some other things that I have to say about that in terms of just the idea of animal sacrifice itself. But did anyone else want to comment on that aspect before I do?
This is Gary.
Mm-hmm.
I was just thinking that also as it's put here, then the one presenting the offering, it's to be done with a contrite heart. I mean, none of this means anything. You're just cutting up blood and cook it, unless you, the one presenting the offering, as today, the one confessing sins and praying, is doing it in supplication and a contrite heart. True. Because you know well in Isaiah 1 what all this made God sick when people were just doing it as a ritual. He was sick of this. Of these offerings. And they made him sick and they made him mad.
Sure.
Because it was not done with, you know, everything here is meant, you know, it's from your herd, it's your animal. No doubt you brought that animal up from a newborn. And it's, you know, if you're like me, every one of my animals would be important to me. I don't know, it's life. It's another form of life, but it's life, and it still is, you know, I hate to see any kind of animal get killed or mutilated for any reason, because it's a life. So if you do this in the cold, with a cold heart, it doesn't bring forth your real feelings, the real confessions, then I believe we're doing it in vain.
Indeed.
Absolutely. God knows our hearts. We cannot fool him.
That's mm-hmm. true.
Yeah, no, see, formalism, that's exactly what it is. It's just you don't take things to heart. It's not, the true impact of it isn't felt. And it's just doing the form, going through the motions.
And nothing is accomplished. Nothing real. It was performed. Nothing real was done.
Indeed.
It was all in vain. A lie. And a lie is immaterial. A lie will never test time. A lie will die.
Mm-hmm. Only a contrary claim. It looks like somebody else had a comment as well.
Yeah, this is Ed. I was just thinking, you know, kind of going along with what Carol said, but not only that, but it's a free will offering. So this person, you know, has made the decision that they're going to do this, not because of some sin that they created or whatever, and it kind of made me think of the heavenly family when they gave Jesus to us. I mean, it must have been, I mean, obviously in a way greater way, but I wonder if there's some symbolism there, you know, the feeling that you would have giving your animal free will to be slaughtered, basically, is probably somewhat symbolic of how the heavenly family felt when they gave Jesus.
See, that's a very interesting point as well. The idea of giving an offering itself being kind of imaging or picturing our heavenly family giving Christ. And that's definitely, you know, an important aspect to really consider and to carry that thought through and investigate it more, because there may very well be other aspects to that whole idea of picturing the divine in bringing an offering. Fulfilling that role of being an image of our heavenly family. And I just want to mention as a side note on that, some burnt offerings were brought as free will, but then there's also offerings that were prescribed for certain times, different burnt offerings, like the daily burnt offering, and then there was the other burnt offerings appointed for feasts, which were commanded to be brought. So I just wanted to mention that so that as we continue investigating, we can see perhaps where some of those lessons apply in a more vivid sense, and other times where it may be emphasizing other aspects. And that's a good overall question to investigate, the difference between prescribed offerings at certain times, offerings that are prescribed for certain circumstances, so that's not at a set time, it's just in certain circumstances, and then also then there's just totally free will offerings. So that's something that, as we're reading, we should kind of pay attention, you know, what does it say with for each offering? What type is it? Is it prescribed for a certain time? Is it prescribed for a certain circumstance? Or is it entirely free will? And what's the difference between all of those? Did you have something, Carol?
Yeah, I did. And I can't find the statement. I think it was maybe in the last silver trumpet, but I'm not sure. But anyway, it was something having to do with the fact, you know, that that we actually identify with Christ's offering. And when we do that, you know, then we become ourselves an offering. And so I was thinking about that last night as well when I was just contemplating this whole issue. And so I think that this statement might actually be getting at that. See what you think. This is from Ellen White in The Desire of Ages, page 668. All true obedience comes from the heart. It was heart work with Christ, and if we consent, he will so identify himself with our thoughts and aims, so blend our hearts and minds into conformity to his will, that when obeying him, we shall be but carrying out our own impulses. So it's kind of that blending, you know, of our hearts and minds into conformity, so that eventually there becomes no difference between our mind, the way that we think, and the way our Heavenly Family thinks, to the point at which we just lay down our lives.
Absolutely. That's just the heart of the matter right there. That's just the heart of it, because, I mean, this whole thing, it's Christ's sacrifice that we make our own. You know, his sacrifice was so much more than just his death. His sacrifice was giving up the position that he had in heaven, giving up the glory that he had, the very physical nature that he had, and entering into an entirely different kind of existence. And he truly gave up all for us, even his own life. That is such a sacrifice. And that, you know, making his sacrifice our own is just, it's giving up all for the sake of Christ and for the sake of everyone else. First John really kind of emphasizes that principle as well.
And I think the love is full circle. Christ gave himself for us, and then that love breaks our heart. You know, our heart is broken on the rock, that then in turn we want to give ourselves back to him.
We love him because he first loved us.
Yes. So full circle.
Amen.
And it breaks actually.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead. No, go ahead.
I was just going to say that's how love has to be. You know, it has to be continually growing, and it has to be shared. That's, you know,
it has to grow.
The community,
right?
Has to grow. Amen.
If it doesn't grow, it dies. Right.
Yes. Just like any living thing, absolutely.
Right.
Hey, so on this issue of animal sacrifice in general, I was thinking of just reading something to you guys, just because there was a small exchange that I had with someone on the issue of animal sacrifices, because there's different ways that people approach it. There's a lot of people who, let's say, in one way or another, promote animal sacrifice for now. I mean, we promote sacrifice for now, but we don't promote animal sacrifices because there's a change in the observance of the law. But, you know, you find these things in Scripture, even in the Old Testament, where it's talking about sacrifice and how the sacrifices of these animals that were being done in the temple in Jerusalem at certain times was just totally not pleasing to Yahweh. And it's because of the idea of formalism and so on. But here's the thing. When people approach this issue of sacrifice, there are many people, and I know some people like this, who really look at animal sacrifice as such a good thing. And it's something to glory in. And like I know a guy, for instance, who at least on Passover actually sacrifices animals and enjoys it and so on, because he believes it's something that's supposed to be enjoyed. It's a commandment that was given to sacrifice these animals, and so it's a good thing inherently and should be done, and that it will never be changed in any way, that it's to continue on with sacrificing animals. And then you have others who, hearing anything about sacrificing animals, just totally churns their stomachs and disgusts them. And a lady that I have a brief Facebook conversation with, there's a lady who had kind of mentioned some things about sacrifice. I had posted a verse. It was Psalm 154, and it talks about he-goats and calves and so on, just as part of that psalm. And, you know, this person was just absolutely repulsed by the idea of sacrificing animals. Like, how could you do that? And if you think about it, if you're totally coming from a perspective that is, you know, you don't really care about the Bible, you don't care about religion or whatever, and then you talk about, you hear about people slaughtering animals in worship of their God, it sounds really messed up. And it sounds like, okay, well, obviously that religion is just totally, totally wrong and messed and even disgusting. You know, you could see how someone could easily have that perspective. And personally, I think that in at least in many regards, perhaps not exactly as I described it, but in a lot of ways, that is the natural reaction that you would find from human beings. That's what a normal mind would do in response to this animal sacrifice idea, to be repulsed. And I remember seeing a video before of a young child, I would guess, you know, anywhere from 5 to 7, and he had a goat that was part of his family setup and everything. You know, they had goats, they had all their pets, and they were bringing this animal to go get sacrificed. And when this kid found out what was going to happen, that it was going to get sacrificed, he just started bawling incredibly and just yelling out, like, no, like, you know, and standing between his parents and the animal and just wanting to defend it no matter what and keep it alive. And he's crying and hugging it and holding it and just totally distraught.
Saying things like, we shouldn't kill animals, we're not supposed to do that, and I don't know, stuff like that.
Yeah. Yeah, and I mean, that's just a little child. And any little child, unless something is really wrong, is going to respond that way to animal sacrifice. That in itself should let us know something. Okay, why is it that just the normal instinct is to be repulsed by that? And then how do you explain the idea of animal sacrifice? Why do we have it? Why was it ever commanded if it's so repulsive? So I want to read you guys something here that I wrote kind of in response to this whole thing. And before I do, I want to mention another brief principle. And that's the origin of animal sacrifice. And especially, I mean, if you look back...
The origin
of
animal sacrifice.
Trent, I need to tell you that, I don't know if it's just me or not, but there's a lot of distortion in your voice, and sometimes words don't come through. Is anybody else getting that?
No.
No.
Voice comes very clear, but sometimes it breaks up.
Okay, well, maybe I need to call back in.
All right, so I'll wait a moment for you to call back in.
Oh, thank you. Okay, bye.
Bye.
While we were waiting, I was thinking of you could contrast the sacrifice of animals with the religion of Israel, with the sacrifice of humans, with many pagan religions, which would be far worse, I would think.
Certainly, I mean, there is limits placed on the sacrificial system. Both are awful, though. both are awful, but certainly.
And I think that's the intent, right? To the exceeding sinfulness of sin, which requires blood.
Absolutely.
And it's kind of tricky when you go to answer someone, they can say, well, why does it require blood? What kind of a God do you serve? They require blood. That sounds like a bloodthirsty God, you know? So these are definitely things that we need to understand what it's really all about.
Yeah, it depends on what you mean when you say require blood, because some people take that as, and in fact, if you have this is a while back now, I remember seeing a debate between a Christian and a Muslim, and the Christian made the religion of the New Testament seem so terrible just because the way he answered, and he was answering sincerely according to his belief, and this is what the majority of Christians do believe, but it made no sense to the Muslim at all, because, you know, the Christian is saying, look, the wages of sin are death. Death is required. There had to be someone die. And so that's why Jesus was sent, so that we could be forgiven. And the Muslim is just, you know, kind of confused and saying, well, why, you know, if someone has wronged me, I can just forgive them. I don't need to, you know, kill someone or anything. I wouldn't take my son and say, look, you did something really wrong against me, so this needs to be punished and someone needs to die. But because I love you so much, instead of killing you, I'll kill my son, and then I'll forgive you. You know, I mean, it makes absolutely no sense.
But that person's the victim. It's not the person that set the law.
I missed what you said.
The person, who somebody killed my brother. My brother's a victim. I'm a victim. I'm collateral. So we're victims. But we didn't make that law. They broke the law of God. You see what I'm saying? They're a victim.
They can't just
it's only God that can give, can release you from that sin, per se, or forgiveness for that sin. Because you broke the law, and the person who died, if it was murder, they're a victim. So, if I'm the victim's brother, I can't say that. I can forgive that person from my standpoint, but I can't judge him from God's standpoint.
I think that I'll try and clarify this a little bit more because I think there might be part of this. I could be wrong, but there might be part of this that you missed.
Yeah.
Because the point is, you know, the Muslim is looking at this, at a Christian belief, and he's looking at how Christians portray God. And basically how God is being portrayed is like, and even if you want to have God being the lawgiver, you could say, okay, so God makes a law. And perhaps God didn't even have to make the law this way in Christian belief. So God makes a law that makes it that death is basically the required punishment for sin. And so someone sins, and then there has, you know, God, because of his love for that person, wants to make a means for them to be forgiven. So what he does is he says, well, someone has to die because of this sin, but instead of you dying, I'll just have my son die, and then I'll forgive you. And so the Muslim is looking at that and saying, well, that doesn't make any sense, because if I or whoever is wronged, someone is sinned against, someone does something bad to someone else, why can't you just forgive them? Why do you have to kill your son or something like that happen? That's what the Muslim is saying in response to the Christian. And that is actually a good and fair response. Like, why, like, that actually doesn't make any sense. It would only be truly a someone who is really a maniac who would say, well, look, you did something wrong, and so you deserve to die. Someone's got to die. I need to have someone die in order for me to forgive you. So I'm just going to kill my son in order for me to be able to forgive you. You know, I mean, that just, it really would not make any sense. And so that's, you know, this Muslim was raising that to the Christian. And then he said, and furthermore, why does God have to, if someone has to die, why would God kill his own son? How selfish and how awful. Why wouldn't he go and die himself? And then the Christian replies, well, he did come and die himself. Because, of course, the Christian view, you know, God coming and God dying and Jesus being the very God, the one triune God in most Christian doctrine. And so, and then the reply is, okay, well, how does that make any more sense? Because then you have a God saying, I made a law that makes it so that someone has to die if something bad happens, and instead of making you die in order for you to be forgiven, I'm going to kill myself so that I can forgive you. You know, it doesn't make any more sense. It's still just totally nonsensical.
Can I make a comment?
Sure.
I thought for sure that I had read in Sister White's writings that it was actually Jesus who first offered himself, because they loved us, you know, they loved their creation so much, and I thought my understanding was that he offered himself, and it had to be agreed. The Father actually, and that the Father almost decided not. No, I don't want you to do it.
Yes,
but of course, it didn't turn out that way.
Yes. They were in council
and so
three times.
He offered himself first. It was his, that's just who he was. And of course, the Godhead, we know they are separate, but they think as one. And so I thought it had to be agreed on. And of course, Mrs. White didn't know the truth, evidently, of the mother and the sister there. And so I always just assumed that he had to get the Father's approval or whatever, but that he contemplated a no answer, but that it was decided, oh, okay, because it did require one of them. It would have required one of them, a non-created being, to do that.
So I just wonder what you, if you've read that too, and if that would make it mean more sense to say Christ offered himself and it was agreed on by the heavenly family.
Right. So, yeah, Ellen White talks about that, and that is true, but that's a totally separate issue from what I'm referring to here. In other words, it wouldn't, if that's the only difference of, well, it wasn't God who chose for Christ to die, but Christ to die for himself, then that's no different from the circumstance of a God saying, well, you did wrong, but I want to forgive you in some way, so I'm going to kill myself in order to forgive you. You know, it still makes no sense.
Keep in mind, this is all being discussed in the light of what someone else is, how someone else is viewing this doctrine of the quote-unquote Bible and the sacrificial system of killing animals and
the sacrifice of Christ.
Exactly.
We're talking about what I was laying out there is the theology of most of Christianity, which we do not agree with, and the theology of a Muslim in response to that, which we also don't agree with as far as the... basically, it's just the Muslim's rejection of that Christian viewpoint, which we also reject. But the Muslim doesn't understand the truth of what the scriptures do say about sacrifice. And so it's basically, you know, the Muslim in the debate that I saw wouldn't necessarily distinguish between what the Christian was saying and what Scripture says, what the New Testament says. So the reason why I'm mentioning all this is because it's important to understand the actual reason for sacrifice, the logic for sacrifice, and the way that we have been taught to view sacrifice, just the general idea of sacrifice that is all throughout Christianity, actually does not make any sense. It actually makes for a maniacal God. It is important to understand that that's not the truth, what we have become accustomed to believe. Again, that being that, well, someone sinned and God just wanted to find a way to forgive people, but it just required that someone die in order for that to happen. And so therefore either God came himself or Jesus came himself or God sent Jesus or whatever to die so that he could forgive everyone. That whole idea is what we're talking about. It doesn't matter really which member of the Godhead it was or anything like that, but that whole general idea, and it really just simply doesn't make sense.
So Trent's going to, he's just saying all that to set the stage for what he's about to read, and this is something that he wrote in response to someone who is not a Christian, not a religious person at all, who read a post that he made that referred to animal sacrifice, even just very so slightly. But that slight reference to animal sacrifice turned her stomach, and she was very upset about a religion that would promote the killing of animals. So he's bringing all this up to emphasize that it is important, it's imperative that we understand the truth of the sacrificial system, what it's all about, how it came about, and all that. And he's setting the stage by explaining how absurd it sounds from an outside perspective when it's portrayed in the light that most of Christianity portrays it. And that light that most Christianity portrays it in is false light.
And that it rightfully sounds absurd.
Exactly. So we can't just try to defend a way of religion that we've been brought up with as being right and good just because it's associated with a book we call the Bible and someone we call God. Because that's not a good enough reason. It shouldn't be a good enough reason for anybody, but it's definitely not a good enough reason for a non-believer. But if we ever want to reach non-believers, and if we ever want to reach believers with the actual truth, we should really be able to understand what this is all about. So, you know, it's not anything that we're used to, most of us, I would gather, or I would wager to say, are not used to even thinking about the sacrificial system to a very large degree. Now, we are right now because our Heavenly Family has been agitating the topic, and they want us to understand it. But really, it's not something that is studied into very much. And if so, it's usually not with an emphasis on, you know, how it came about and why, other than just the typical stuff of, oh, well, there's this law, the wages of sin is death, and so God loved us so much that he sent his only begotten son to die in our stead. But even then, we've had this misconception of, oh, it's so we can continue sinning. We never have to overcome all of our sin because God died for us. And so it's just all this circular reasoning, and none of it ever makes any sense. So we're about to hear why it makes sense, or how, what the truth of it is. That's what I'm really meaning to say.
And actually, there's another principle brought up there that I just want to briefly touch on. And then there may have been someone else with the comment, but the principle, you know, Teresa mentioned there someone kind of defending a belief of what they are used to or grew up in, or something that's associated with the Bible or whatever. This is something that's really important. Very often, you know, if people hear a debate or they watch a debate and they are a Christian, and it's a Christian versus a non-Christian, let's say, the Christians will tend to simply agree with the person who is debating in favor of Christianity on all these different points. When that's just, instead of taking each thing on its own merits and investigating it and finding out, someone will tend to agree with the person that is defending the position which they would adhere to. Likewise, like if you have a Christian debating an atheist will basically agree with what the atheist is saying without necessarily critically examining things. So, you know, you'll have things like a creationist debating an evolutionist. And a lot of people, if they're a Christian, will just agree with everything the creationist says without critically thinking about it. And you know, some creationists, for instance, promote the idea that the whole universe only came into existence 6,000 years ago, when that's actually not scriptural, and Ellen White definitely didn't teach that. You know, we had the other worlds and all of that, and it talks about in Job, it talks about the angels rejoicing when he went to make creation that we read about in Genesis 1 and so on. So that lets us know that the whole universe is older than 6,000 years, but a lot of Christians and even Adventists would listen to a debate, you know, creation versus evolution, and the creationist is promoting as part of it, oh, well, you know, we know that the universe can't be that old because this and that and this and that, and an Adventist most of the time would just, well, yeah, you know, rooting for him and agreeing with what's being said, even though it contradicts Adventist doctrine and scripture. But it's just because the person is generally arguing for something that we agree with. And so we tend to
take everything. So there's lots of things that Christians believe and teach that we don't hold in common, and other things that we do hold in common. So we have to examine each thing on its own merits, and I just think that that's an important principle. Before I read this now, was there something else that anyone had to say?
Yeah, I had a couple of points on, or three, and I forgot one of them. First one was that the statement that sin requires blood is just another way of saying that sin leads to death. I mean, even without the law or regulations in place or an authority given, you know, a set of people in a certain environment, they start abusing each other in one way or another. Someone will eventually die because of it. It has to be dealt with. And saying that can't I just forgive the person is somewhat naive in believing that the person wants to be forgiven. You know, the person has to realize that the one who is the offender has to realize that he has offended and needs to be forgiven. You know, just because somebody forgives the offender doesn't stop him from offending. He will keep on offending unless there is repercussions. So there's some naivety there. And I think there was, well, that's like I said, I can only remember those two points.
Yeah, I would definitely agree when it comes to, you know, what you said with sin requiring death and the way that you explained it here, which, as far as I understand, that's how you intended it from the beginning, and I would totally agree with that. Understanding in that context of sin naturally leads to death, that is totally true. On the second issue of forgiveness, the way that I would kind of express it is, you know, the example that I gave there of a Christian and a Muslim talking, the idea of, well, why can't you just forgive someone? That's based off of a misconception of what forgiveness itself is. And so, you know, is the way that most people think of it is that forgiveness is just the person who had something done wrong against them no longer holding bad feelings toward the person who wronged them. That's how most people view forgiveness. That's not really what forgiveness is in the scriptural sense. It's not about feelings, and it's not about a change in the attitude of the person who had been wronged. It's not that God even has this bad attitude or grudge against us for doing wrong and then needs to change his attitude toward us. And, you know, people even talk about forgiving people as almost a therapy to improve yourself. Oh, you're holding these grudges. It's wearing you down. You need to let go. You need to forgive these people. And it's about the person who had done something or who had something wrong done to them. Forgiveness, in the way most people think of it, isn't about the person who did something wrong. Forgiveness in Scripture, when God forgives someone, it's not about God changing his attitude. It's about God changing the person. And it's the person changing their attitude which allows for God to change them. As far as the idea of God loving you and accepting you and all of that, I mean, God, and this, depending on how you define acceptance and what all you mean by that, in some respects, God just loves and accepts everyone regardless of their sin, you know? And so it's, yeah, that whole idea, again, it's based off a misconception of what forgiveness actually is. And when we have a clearer and more accurate understanding of forgiveness, it definitely helps to answer some of the issues involved with the misunderstanding of sacrifice.
Amen.
I just want to say one quick thing. I know you need to get on with your...
Sure, no, it's good.
What you wrote, but I'm looking at the silver trumpet, numbers 12 through 14, page 30, and it's talking about this issue really super clearly in the second full paragraph. You know, and it just talks about how Yahweh forgives sins, but it's just that we have to die to self in order to receive it. And, you know, and that's the thing that I'm getting about the sacrificial system, as heinous as it is for me to look at, and as hard as it is for me to even, you know, think about at times, you know, oh, that this God we're serving, you know, has to have all these things happen to these animals, because I love animals and I have a soft heart for animals. But the thing is that, you know, as you were saying, we'll learn more as we learn more about forgiveness. Well, as we learn more about the sacrificial system, we will learn more about forgiveness, and we'll learn more about how our heavenly family, you know, how they so freely forgive us, you know, as shown by placing the blood upon the four horns of the altars, or how they're willing to bear our sins, and, you know, just every aspect of that is shown clearly in this ceremonial system.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. One thing that I think is significant is that in the sacrifices, it's never the priest who actually slays the animal. That is, of course, unless the priest isn't acting as a priest, but for whatever reason, the priest himself is bringing a sacrifice and another priest is doing the priestly activity. But in the sacrificial setup, the priest never actually slays the animal. It's actually the person who slays the animal. And I guess as we continue in this, maybe as I read this short few paragraphs that I've written here, that the reason for that might become more clearly understood.
In verse 15 of Leviticus 1, it does say that the priest brings it into the altar and rings off its head when it's talking about the bird sacrifices. So there's some difference.
Yes. For the bird sacrifice, yes, absolutely. The sacrifice of the bird, actually the only thing that the presenter does is to bring it to the priest.
Right.
And that's it. And that's, you know, that is something, as we are going through this, there's a really big differences in the sacrifices of the birds for the burnt offerings as compared to the other animals.
Can I give you the immediate impression that I just received about that?
Sure.
The difference says, as he pointed out, the priest would pinch off its head and offer the head up in smoke on the altar, and its blood must be drained out against the side of the altar. It's the volume of blood that makes the difference. Don't know what that means, but that's what I was impressed with when we read it.
Well, that's something that we can certainly put to the test and investigate as we go through this.
Okay.
For sure.
Sorry I interrupted.
Oh, no, that's good. I'm glad that you mentioned it. So the sacrifice of the bird, again, has some major differences in how the sacrifice is actually done as compared to animal from the flock and animal from the herd. And as we're going through, we should definitely take note of things and
pay close attention to the details and see what the differences are. And Heavenly Family, please do show us the meaning of all the differences. All right, so I think I'll just read this, what I've written here, in reply. Again, this is a situation where the person is not religious and the idea of animal sacrifices just, you know, sounds totally awful. And one of the things that I'll also briefly mention before this is that for a long time among biblical scholars, the general view about animal sacrifice has been to view it as non-symbolic, that it wasn't symbolic, that it had to do with honoring gods, feeding the gods, different things like that, and that it's just an ancient type of ritual with no true logic behind it, and that it's just simply about sacrificing animals. And people who are not religious also tend to view it in that same way. They just, you know, someone's talking about animal sacrifices, they're just thinking animal sacrifices. They're not thinking of any symbolism to those actions. But it's really important to understand that this system is a symbolic service. That's how it was from the beginning. And there's a lot of ancient precedent for that, that this whole thing of purity and sacrifice is indeed symbolic. That that's not a later interpretation by the writers of the New Testament that just kind of spiritualizes everything, so to speak, is how people would view it. That no, it was intended to be symbolic from the beginning.
Amen.
So this is what I mentioned to this person. So the question is, you know, well, didn't you say about goats and calves? Because I mentioned that, no, we don't sacrifice animals, because there's, you know, the question was asked if we sacrifice animals. So I explained that we don't, and then it's, you know, the question is, well, why is there mention of goats and calves then? And so I mentioned, you know, yes, but it is important to understand that the system of animal sacrifices spoken of in the Bible is a symbolic system. The death of the animal is a symbol to teach that death is the natural consequence of wickedness. An innocent animal dying at the hands of a wicked human is an illustration of the death of the innocent because of the wicked. The animal died in place of the human when really it was the wicked human who deserved to die. It is really a terrible thing because the animals died due to wickedness they didn't commit. But the wicked person lives on, and thus the wickedness lives on. This just shows that wickedness causes death, and that, unfortunately, the innocent too often die in place of the wicked. And, you know, you take this all the way through. Once you start with a little wickedness, again, wickedness has its root in a lack of love. That's really what wickedness is when you get down to it. You have a lack of love. That lack of love, no matter what, will continue to grow. If you don't allow love to grow in you towards someone, you will begin to disdain them. You will dislike them and hate them. And eventually, it leads to death. No matter what. And the history of the world just testifies to that as factual reality. Over and over and over and over again, people killing each other, and starts with a little wickedness, you know, what seems to be a little wickedness, and always leads to death. So again, the animal sacrifice is an illustration of that. It's an innocent animal. The animal didn't do anything. So this whole thing is showing
the natural result of wickedness, and how too often the innocent die instead of the wicked. And in that sense, it is in place of the wicked. And that in itself is a tragic thing, because the wickedness then perpetuates. That's part of the nature of wickedness. If someone embodies wickedness, they take down others with them. They take down the innocent. And it's just tragic all the way around. Wickedness then doesn't end. It perpetuates as long as it does. So, continuing on with this. In the first century, there was a man named John who announced the arrival of Jesus and called him the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins or wickedness of the world. Jesus was innocent like a lamb, and yet he was killed by wicked men. He was perfectly righteous, and yet he died in the place of wicked men such as ourselves. The fact is that we have all engaged in wickedness, and wickedness always leads to death, either the death of ourselves or the death of others. This is actually what we are supposed to learn from the death of Jesus. He unjustly died because of our wickedness. Notice unjustly, unjustly died. If someone killed an innocent animal because of their own wickedness, the right thing for them to do to make amends would be for them to let their own wickedness die so they don't cause any more death.
Amen.
It is the same thing when it comes to Jesus. If our hearts aren't moved by his death so that we stop our wickedness, we will just keep on doing wicked things and bringing about more death. But if we do let his death touch our hearts, then we can let our own wickedness die and instead become righteous like him. Thus, his death won't be in vain. Again, this is just a very, very simple principle of, hey, if someone is wicked and they do something that causes someone's death, just seeing what they've done, seeing how awful it is, and how they actually caused someone to die because of that, that could touch their hearts in such a way that they no longer do wickedness, that they turn from their wickedness because they just simply see how awful it is, and they hate it, and they want love again. They want love, and so they allow that to change them. That's the lesson here. So the death of an animal is actually a really sad and awful thing. And in the scriptures, it is used as a symbol of something even more sad and awful, the death of Jesus. But through that awful experience, many more lives can be saved, so long as we learn the lesson. Here's the thing. If everyone just accepted Christ, everyone repented and accepted Christ, he wouldn't have had to die. You know, he wouldn't have had to be killed. It's just an awful thing. Think about this. Christian theology too often makes it seem like, oh, this is just... And in fact, I've heard Christians say multiple times, well, you know, the Roman soldiers who killed him ultimately were doing the will of God. Judas was ultimately doing the will of God. You know, all these people who brought about the death of Christ were ultimately doing the will of God.
There's even a writing in the Hebrew Roots movement that says the right to slay the lamb, or right to kill the lamb, or one of those types of titles. And it teaches, as part of a collegiate course study, that the priests were just doing what was going to be done anyway, It's just they could have been nicer about it, basically.
Right. So, you know, this idea that, well, it's doing the will of God anyway, so it's okay, just take that thought and contrast it with the actual record we have of the crucifixion. Think of how dark it was. Darkness actually covered the land. You know, it was, yeah, for 3 hours. Darkness covered the land for 3 hours. And Christ was just enshrouded in darkness. Ellen White talks about how the Father turned away. Christ himself says, my God, why have you forsaken me? It was weeping, it was mourning, it was darkness, it was awful. You don't have the angels rejoicing like you did at his birth. No, it's weeping, you know. It's not some wonderful, wonderful thing. Yes, finally, the will of God is done in the death of his son. This is an awful thing that took place, that Christ was killed, that he was murdered, that he had to die. Now, that doesn't mean it's not on our behalf. You know, people confuse that sometimes where they think, well, but he died for us. Well, yeah, he died for us, and we killed him, you know? And it is on our behalf, and it is for us, but why is that? It's because we can learn how awful we are through it. We can learn the consequences of sin. We can learn how awful it really is that we would actually kill the one who came to save us. Again, it's not the flesh of Christ that gives us life. He tells us that plainly in John 6, the words that he speaks to us. If we had accepted his words, we wouldn't have killed him, and it would have been a good thing not for us to kill him. So what happens is that his words and his life and the fact that he came and all of that is an incredible expression of love. He came knowing, it was prophesied ahead of time, that he would die for us, both through the sacrificial system and through the more direct prophecies, you might say, of the prophets such as David and Isaiah. So he knew that he was going to come and die, and yet he did it anyway, just so that we can learn how awful it is, and so that he could come and personally express his love.
And show us how that we can overcome too.
Absolutely.
Show us that we don't have to perpetuate sin, and we don't have to perpetuate death, and that we don't have to die a physical, literal, eternal death, because he showed us how to overcome.
He showed us how to overcome, exactly. So he's coming to show us how awful and wicked sin is and where it leads, but also how not to sin anymore.
In fact, you know, the more I'm thinking about it, it is so turned around what Christianity focuses on. Now, I'm not trying to belittle the sacrifice that Christ made. His death was horrible, but all the emphasis is put on his death. He died in our place so that we don't have to die. But there's not any emphasis in really any Christianity other than the branch that I'm aware of that emphasizes his life of overcoming so that we too can actually overcome. Yeah, there's some mention in SDA about, you know,
Christ, our example.
Christ is our example, and he overcame, and we don't have to sin. We can overcome, but we're not going to. That is what is taught. But the truth of his coming was to show us how to stop sinning. And yes, he was also put to a horrible death in the process.
And that because he absolutely refused to sin.
And so we, too, can have that death to self that he experienced. And after that, it didn't end. He rose to life.
So, in other words, again, the right thing for a person, if a person, through their own wickedness, kills an innocent animal, the right thing would for them to do would be to turn from their wickedness so they don't kill anymore. Just so, with the righteousness of Christ and the sacrifice of Christ, we see the wickedness that we have done, we recognize how awful it is, and we turn from wickedness and become innocent, like the Lamb. You know, we take on the life of Christ. That's us dying. So in other words, death is the result of sin. We've gone through that. It's the result. It's what is going to happen. So the true substitution, the substitutionary death of Christ, is that we recognize he already died. You know, my sin already caused death. And what Christ came to show is that it doesn't need to cause more so long as it ends. You know, it's already caused enough death. So turn from the wickedness, and it no longer needs to cause death. So the reason why his death is substitutionary is because simply if we let his death be our own, in other words, we take on his attitude and all that, his death becomes our own. We die to self. We die to everything that he died to. Pride, glory, self, all of that. And the death then is already done. Its sin has actually had its natural consequences take place. Again, that's, to just contrast that, most of Christianity teaches that the substitutionary death of Christ is that you die, you deserve punishment. So Christ was punished instead, just so that you don't have to be. I hope you can see the difference there. There's no actual cause and effect. There's no logic to it. It's just, well, it had to be done because God demanded it, or because the law demanded it, or because Satan demanded it and God was making a bargain with the devil to hand over his son so other people don't have to die, you know. But there's no actual logic or cause to effect of Christ dying actually bringing about eternal life or actually causing people to turn from their wickedness. But that's the true substitutionary death. Death is the natural result of sin. Death already happened. Our wickedness caused his death. And that should normally and naturally cause us to see his love in coming regardless of that. And to see the wickedness of sin should cause us to turn from it. Thereby, we are now a new person, no longer deserving of death because of taking on his life and his righteousness and his innocence. So I really do hope that was helpful and clear for everyone on here, because the logic of sacrifice is so, so very important.
Yes.
Are you able?
Very clear, and thank you. It was good.
Praise our Heavenly Family.
The genuine reason for the season, correct?
Amen.
Yeah, you mentioned you wrote that, Trent. Is that written that you can email it to us?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, it's on his Facebook wall, too.
Yeah, you could see it on my Facebook
but we'll email it
page or whatever as well if you want.
Not everyone's on Facebook.
Yeah.
Could you include it in a silver trumpet?
Very likely it will be included in a silver trumpet, the same ideas, but rewritten to suit that circumstance. Because, you know, in writing to this person, I'm writing to suit that circumstance and writing in a way to benefit that individual person as much as possible. So in the silver trumpet, it'll be in a different form, probably, but the same truths, I would think, will be in the next issue of the Silver Trumpet.
But a question and answer, a good fit.
Possibly. Or it might even be part of the main article, because the whole subject is about sacrifice and purity and the whole, you know, what is happening in this priestly law.
Can I make a comment about the sacrificial system in general?
Yes, absolutely.
in regard to what you've been talking about, you know, there's such a vast difference between the sacrificial system of our heavenly family and the sacrificial systems of the wicked gods. And, you know, paganism has gotten into Christianity, of course, and that's why we don't see the truth of this sacrifice. We don't see that the whole sacrificial system was designed to capture our hearts and to turn our hearts toward them and to bring us to be holy, you know, consecrated to our heavenly family and to obey out of love. I mean, it's all about our hearts. It's the heart work, you know, that Sister White talks about. But the sacrificial system of the wicked gods, on the other hand, is all about appeasement of the gods so that they can give you what you want. You don't have to give up your selfish heart. You keep your selfish heart. You come to the gods, they've got selfish hearts. They demand something from you. You're willing to give it because you get what you want in return. And it's just that, it's just so simple. And the devil, you know, the wicked gods have put that those ideas, you know, and they've ascribed those to our heavenly family. And so that's, you know, the issue. You can see that in the sense of, you know, it's almost like we have to appease the Father. And, okay, Jesus was willing to appease the Father so that he can still love us and, you know, still be able to look at us or, you know, care about us, forgive us,
and
or whatever.
And his death was to appease the Father.
Yes, his death was to appease the Father. And so if we believe in that, and then there are certain things, you know, that most of them aren't taught outright, but, you know, we know what they are. You know, just those certain things that you're supposed to do that, you know, appease our heavenly family. So you can still, you don't have to give up your selfish heart, but you can still get what you want, you know, and it's just that, that kind of a unloving, selfish relationship. You know, I want, I get. And, you know, I couldn't find in the Silver Trumpet, I'm pretty sure it's in number 10 and 11, you know, where you talk about the idols, about the idols of wood in regards to Davidians, you know, and how they have turned something that was, you know, living and beautiful, but it has, oh, it's the wood, yeah, because the wood is only good in the sense that it gives off that aroma, that pleasing aroma, as long as it has the sap. So as long as it has, you know, the present truth, as long as it has the sap in it, it's good. But Davidians have, you know, the idea is that the wood does no longer have the sap, if I understand that correctly. And, you know, talking about, just thinking about how you know, a prophet, a dead prophet in particular, or any prophet can be made into an idol, you know, and normally we think of somebody thinking too highly of that person or that person's writings. But actually, you know, if you approach them as an idol, I think you, you know, got at this in that passage or in that section that you were talking about it in, that that you approach them like, the way you approach an idol is like this. Okay, I'm going to carve you into this image, and then you are going to meet my needs. You know, just like the one-armed bandit kind of an idea, you know. And that's that same paganistic approach.
Absolutely. I really appreciate the simplicity and clarity in which you just described that. And I think that passage in the Silver Trumpet, again, the Silver Trumpet, Volume 1, Numbers 10 to 11, I think it's page 24 to 31. I think it's in that passage. If anyone wants to read that. Absolutely. I mean, that whole idea, just as you explained there, it's really paganism that's entered into Christianity that has caused that terrible misconception and that view of sacrifice and appeasement and, you know, the idea of even Christ's death being for the purpose of appeasing the Father. And it ends up being the focus on the flesh of Christ itself, the body of Christ, the death of Christ itself being the thing which saves us. Which, again, that external reality can't save anyone if they don't actually receive from Christ. I mean, there's even, let me see if I can just find something real quick here, because I'm pretty sure this is even in the Gospel according to the Hebrews. Let's see.
The idea of a vindictive God as opposed to our true Father and Heavenly Family, who is actually on trial. Instead of us being on trial, they are on trial. And praise all that is good and righteous, that they will be vindicated and proven not to be vindictive.
Amen. I don't know if I'm going to be able to find this passage right away, but essentially in this passage, Christ says, even if you lay upon my bosom, but do not the will of my Father, I will cast you from me. And it's just showing that idea that it's like, okay, if we focus just on the flesh of Christ or the death of Christ, but don't allow it to actually change us, so we turn from wickedness, there's no actual benefit in it, you know? And this is to really emphasize and to demonstrate how the idea of sacrifice that's found in paganism has dominated Christianity. All one really has to do is look at the Mass. I mean, think about it. How really what it's about, you know, the idea of transubstantiation, taking this bread and taking this wine, and it is the flesh and the blood of Christ. The priest makes it become, you know, there's a creative act that takes place where the priest, by speaking, causes the bread and wine to become the literal flesh and blood of Jesus, and you eat it. And that is what saves you. That is what sanctifies you. Now, that is, again, there's no actual heart change there. There's no actual reason or logic or cause and effect. You know, how would it be that the physical flesh and blood of Jesus spending time in your digestive system makes you righteous? Or makes you sanctified or saved? You know, there's no way to really reason that out in a way that makes sense, you know. And even theologians in the Middle Ages who believed in transubstantiation would have discussions about things like, well, what if a crumb of the bread falls to the floor after it's been changed into the body of Christ? And a mouse comes along and eats it. Is the mouse sanctified by it? You know, like, these are real questions that these theologians had to ask, because, I mean, they're within this framework and within this mindset when that's what does it. That's what does it. And it's just totally a mystery as to how it does it. But for some reason, the flesh and blood of Jesus apparently have to spend time in your digestive system in order to make someone righteous. And that's the type of thing that actually comes about by means of a false view of sacrifice, a false view of substitutionary death, and a false view of the work of Christ and the character of God. All that stuff can come about just because of that. But if you have the idea of sacrifice straight and what it's about, then it makes a lot more sense, and you don't end up having these mystical, really nonsensical things. There's actually a cause and effect to sacrifice. Anyways, yeah, go ahead, Gary.
Amen, amen. Well, I was just saying that it blew right over their head because Christ said to do this in remembrance of me.
Amen.
Not to do it to try to sanctify yourself through actually trying to eat his flesh, he said, in remembrance of what he done. And by
Amen.
Remembering what he done for us, then he's calling us, he's wooing us with his love to come to me. Remember me and what I done and come to me.
And it's to remember him and to remember his words.
Yes.
The words that he spoke, and to have that
truth right.
going
every
to our mind.
Was, yes, every moment of his life is documented that we can know of, you know.
The counterfeit of the daily as well.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah, the daily, the true suppers of the Lord. It's to remind us of the sacrifice of Christ, and eating it is a symbol of letting that actually change you, letting it have its actual natural effect. And that's, you know, that's what it is, remembering the words of Christ, remembering what he did for us, seeing our own wickedness in sinning, and, you know, what you've done to the least of these, you've done it to me. Christ loves each of us so much that if we kill someone by means of our sin, which when we sin, again, we cause death to people. You know, it's that sin will lead to physical death eventually. And in the meantime, it leads to spiritual death and just to a lack of love all around. And Christ loves everyone so much, and so does the rest of our Heavenly Family, that in sinning against anyone, it is sinning against them. It is sinning against them. And that is the death of Christ right there, you know? So it's recognizing that and letting it change us.
So the idea is that if people really got the truth, you know, understood the truth and let it be a reality in their minds and their hearts of the burnt offering, then they wouldn't need to continue to bring their sin offerings. Is that true?
Well, that gets into a lot of different aspects because a sin offering, again, wasn't just offered because of sin as we would think of sin, but sin offerings were also offered to purify from uncleanness.
Right. I guess what I meant was there were specifically sin offerings that were brought when someone did sin. I mean, just committed sin.
Depending on the sin. But the most common, perhaps, if an overt sin was done.
Of what?
If an overt sin was done, the perhaps most common sacrifice was actually the sacrifice of the person themselves. They were cut off from among God's people. So this is one of those aspects that we need to look into and see, okay, what were the different penalties for different transgressions? If someone broke the Sabbath, for instance, there's no sacrifice for breaking the Sabbath. If someone kills someone, there's no sacrifice for killing someone other than your own.
You just die.
You just die, you know.
You're killed immediately.
Yeah. That's the sacrifice, so to speak, you know, obviously in a different context, they weren't taken to the altar. It wasn't part of a ritual and all that, but that's what takes place. And I think Ellen White points that out as well, how there's no sacrifice for willful transgression. So we need to go and see, okay, well, what are the things that sacrifices were offered for? And if you look at every sin, every transgression, what was the penalty? Other things, if you stole something from someone, you had to pay it back. You had to sacrifice your own possessions multifold, you know, replace and give another, or replace and give however much more. And sometimes you had to replace and then give a sacrifice. Like if you, in one circumstance, it talks about, well, if someone does something and they trespass against the holy things, then they have to bring a sacrifice. Or if someone does something that normally they would bring retribution for, but for whatever circumstance they can't, then instead they bring a sacrifice to the temple. Again, what all those details mean with all the different circumstances, I don't know yet. And in studying this and asking our Heavenly Family, I'm sure they will show us and we will be led to understand all the beautiful lessons.
Hebrews 10:26 is good, will be good right here. You want to hear it? For if we sin willfully after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sin.
That's an incredibly important verse, and it's a hard verse for people to take. Else, in you read from Hebrews 10, correct?
10:26.
Prior to that, in Hebrews 6, it conveys the same idea. One of the things that is specified is being partakers of the gift, receiving the Holy Spirit. And I just want to differentiate, because what does it mean to know the truth in the context in which it's speaking? One can know the truth as in be aware of it. That's one aspect. One can know the truth as in it is acknowledged as being true, although it's not necessarily investing in it in any way. Another way to know the truth is to really know that it is true and to engage yourself with the truth. And lastly, one can know the truth by actually allowing it to embody them. Those are the, you know, some different ways to know the truth. So the question is, which way is it referring to in Hebrews 10? Is it that everyone who hears about the truth, that if they sin, there's no more sacrifice for them? Well, no, right? I mean, Paul, he heard about the truth, and yet he was killing the early believers, and he repented, you know? So in reading what it says in Hebrews chapter 6 about partaking of the gift and so on and so forth, the context seems to be pretty clear that it's justification by faith, and if someone receives justification by faith, there's no more sacrifice. And the reason why, again, it's there's an actual reason for that. It's that the debt has been had, the penalty has been paid, the sacrifice has been accepted, and so it's already, the person has already availed themselves of the rich graces of Christ, and then turn around and spat on it. And that's why there's no more sacrifice, because there simply isn't another sacrifice. It's already been given. So I just wanted to mention that, just in case there was any confusion in anyone's mind of, oh, well, I've heard this truth, and I'm studying present truth, and I know that it's true, but yet I still sin. So does that mean there's no more sacrifice for me, and I have no chance of being saved? No. That's not what it means. I just wanted to mention that in case there was any misunderstanding and someone be
brought to discouragement.
Isn't it in the Mass, though, doesn't the Mass sacrifice Christ afresh every time?
It depends what you mean by that, I suppose.
What was the transfiguration, or not transfiguration?
Transubstantiation.
You know, the idea of crucifying Christ afresh, you know, I was asking kind of in what sense you meant that in connection with the Mass, and there's different ways that one could mean that. Obviously, it's not literally crucifying Christ afresh, because it's not actually becoming his broken flesh and blood and all of that. So that's not actually, you know, becoming anything. But in the sense of perpetuating sin and so on, then absolutely. But I wanted to mention something, because I know some people, and actually an Adventist scholar, Samuel Bakayoki, he actually wrote a review of Mel Gibson's The Passion of the Christ, and he was criticizing it because of basically the Catholic doctrine of fresh atonement, that there's a fresh atonement being made each day through the Mass. And Doug actually wrote a reply to Samuel Bakayoki's review called The Passion of the Gospel. And in it, one of the main things he was showing is that the doctrine of fresh atonement, fresh daily atonement, is actually true. It's just that the Catholic version of it is a perversion of the truth, transubstantiation and all that. But the idea of the continued sufferings of Christ and the cross being uplifted before us each day and contemplating vividly his death, you know, the closing hours of his life and so on, and receiving atonement by means of that contemplation and the realization of the reality of Christ shedding his blood fresh each day in the heavenly sanctuary. That is all part of the true fresh daily atonement of Christ. And again, the idea of a fresh daily atonement is simply right there in the sacrificial service, the daily offerings. So I wanted to mention that because it helps in case there's any confusion over which aspects are false and which aspects are true. It helps to see sometimes what is being spoken of, which aspects of a thing are not inherently false, and so that we can see more clearly the difference, and it helps us to understand the truth. So I hope that made sense.
Amen.
Amen. So, looking at the time, and we've been on here for a while now, 2.5 hours, so we should wrap things up here. Before we do, were there any last comments or questions that anyone had? There's another aspect that I wanted to briefly mention for everyone's contemplation, and that is how the first man and woman would have responded to animal sacrifice. And Ellen White actually talks about this, how Adam and Eve, you know, when they were first exposed to animal sacrifice, you know, what was it like to them? You know, was it some great positive experience, or was it an awful thing? And I think that helps to shed light on the whole sacrificial service altogether. Any other closing comments before we close off? All right, well, I'll pray then, and we'll close off. Heavenly Family, thank you for the truth. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for giving all for us. Even though we have gone into such terrible sin and we and our forefathers have really caused a lot of trouble, perpetuating wickedness. What would things have been like if we did not follow the footsteps of the devil? But Heavenly Family, thank you so much. Thank you for loving us so, so much that you're willing to give up all for us. Thank you, brother, for coming and showing us the way, showing us true life, showing us true love, and being willing to unjustly die because of our wickedness. And Heavenly Family, we do not want that death to be in vain. So whatever can be done so that all of us can realize the enormity of sin and the magnificence of your love because of this, let it be so. Let it be realized. Thank you, Heavenly Family, for helping us to understand with more clarity the truth of sacrifice. Let each heart be moved by it. Thank you so much. Thank you, Father and Mother. In the name of your children, Branch. Amen.
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 Well, love you all, and have a wonderful evening and sleep and everything, and we're looking forward to coming back on here tomorrow and studying more. And I, for one, am grateful to be learning more and more about sacrifice. It certainly means a lot. This is the picture of redemption.
Amen.